A reading from the prophet Isaiah. A shoot springs from the stock of Jesse. The scion thrusts from his roots. On him the spirit of the Lord rests, a spirit of wisdom and insight, a spirit of counsel and power, a spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord is his death. He does not judge by appearances. He gives no verdict on hearsay, but judges the wretched with integrity, and with equity gives a verdict for the poor of the land. His word is a rod that strikes the ruthless. His sentences bring death to the wicked. Integrity is the loincloth round his waist, faithfulness the belt about his hips. The wolf lives with the lamb, the panther lies down with the kid, calf and lion cub feed together. With a little boy to lead them, the cow and the bear make friends, their young lie down together. The lion eats straw like the ox, the infant plays over the cobbler's hole into the viper's lair. The young child puts his hand, they do not hurt, no harm. On all my holy mountain, for the country is filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters swell the sea. That day, the root of Jesse shall stand as a signal to the peoples. It will be sought out by the nations, and its home will be glorious. The word of the Lord. We will say the responsorial psalm together. In his days, justice shall flourish, and peace shall prevail. O God, give your judgment to the king, to a king's son your justice, that he may judge your people in justice, and your poor in righteousness. In his days, justice shall flourish, and peace shall prevail. He shall rule from sea to sea, from the great river to earth's bounds. For he shall save the poor when they cry, and the needy who are helpless. He will have pity on the weak, and save the lives of the poor. May his name be blessed forever, and endure like the sun. Every tribe shall be blessed in him, all nations bless his name. In his days justice shall flourish, and peace to the moon fails.
Second reading, a reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Everything that was written long ago in the scriptures was meant to teach us something about hope from the examples the scripture gives of how people who did not give up were helped by God. And may he who helps us when we refuse to give up help you all to be tolerant with each other, following the example of Christ Jesus, so that united in mind and voice, you may give glory to the God and Father of the Lord Jesus Christ. It can only be to God's glory then for you to treat each other in the same friendly way as Christ treated you. The reason Christ became the servant of circumcised Jews was not only so that God could faithfully carry out the promises made to the patriarchs, it was also to get the pagans to give glory to God for his mercy. As scripture says in one place, "For this I shall praise you among the pagans and sing your name." This is the word of the Lord. Please stand for the gospel proclamation.
Reading from the Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you.
In due course, John the Baptist appeared. He preached in the wilderness of Judea, and this was his message: repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand. This was the man the prophet Isaiah spoke of when he said, a voice cries in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make his path straight. This man, John, wore a garment made of camel hair with a leather belt round his waist, and his fruit was locusts and wild honey. Then Jerusalem and all Judea and the whole Jordan district made their way to him, and as they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, they confessed their sins. But when he saw a number of Pharisees and Sadducees coming from baptism, he said to them, brood of vipers, who warned you to fly from the retribution that is coming? But if you are repentant, produce the appropriate fruit, and do not presume to tell yourselves, we have Abraham for our father. Because I tell you, God can raise children for Abraham from these stones. Even now, the axe is laid to the roots of the trees, so that any tree which fails to produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown on the fire. I baptize you in water for repentance, but the one who follows me is more powerful than I am, and I am not fit to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fan is in his hand. He will clear his threshing floor and gather his wheat into the barn, but the chaff he will burn in a fire that will never go out. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Today's Gospel reading tells us about John the Baptist preaching repentance so that the people can prepare the way for the Lord. Today's reading helps us to prepare ourselves and get ready to welcome Jesus into our lives this Christmas. The first reading from the prophet Isaiah gives us a heavenly vision of what God wants the world to be like. And the prophet Isaiah tells us, there will be peace in all of creation and of earth, and the earth will be filled with the knowledge of God. At the center of the prophet's glorious vision, as I'm sure that you noticed, is a child. Isaiah promises, a little child will guide them. So that is what we are preparing for this holy season. We are getting ready to meet Jesus. In the Gospel reading, we are introduced to the figure of St. John the Baptist, who was sent to prepare people for Jesus. He is really an interesting character, isn't he? He's living out in the desert by the Jordan River. His clothes are made of camel's hair. He's wearing a big leather belt around his waist, and he only eats locusts and wild honey. I think he would be kind of scary to meet, but the clothes he's wearing and what he is eating are meant to be symbols. They are signs that he's totally devoted to God and to doing God's will in his life. And John's message is the beautiful message of God's mercy and forgiveness. He's calling all of us to change our lives. Repent. Prepare the way. Make straight his paths. And that is what this holy season is all about. Advent is a time for conversion. Advent means making a new start in our personal lives. Real conversion means really changing the way we live. That's what the word repent means. To change our lives so that we are ready to live as Jesus wants us to live. And St. John the Baptist gives us some good advice in our gospel reading today. He tells us, first of all, that we need to acknowledge our sins. Yes, we need to accept our weaknesses. We need to admit that we need God's help, that we need his forgiveness, his love, his strength. As you all know, even our Holy Father, Pope Francis, when they asked him to describe himself, he said very simply. Pope Francis described himself in four words: I am a sinner. Yes, the Holy Father, when somebody asked to describe himself, he said, I am a sinner. Four words. If the Holy Father can say that, how much we have to say, I am a sinner. This is the first step in our journey of repentance. Acknowledges our sinful behavior so that God can change us from inside. But then he said right away, and this is what I said when they asked me if I could accept my election as Pope. I am a sinner, but I trust in the infinite mercy and patience of our Lord Jesus Christ. And I accept in a spirit of patience. What a beautiful example of the Holy Father Pope Francis. And that is exactly what St. John the Baptist is talking about today. We need to acknowledge our sins. We need to have a spirit of penance. And we need to trust that Jesus is always patient with us. He has infinite mercy. We need to trust that God's mercy is greater than any of our sins. Then John the Baptist also tells us what we have to do to produce good fruit as evidence of a repentance. Real conversion and good deeds are a wonderful program for this Advent season. But it is demanding. It requires to deny ourselves and to let God act in our lives. And then, believe me, we will feel a beautiful sense of a spiritual freedom. We will find that we are working with God's strength, not with our own. We will find that we are doing all of this, not for ourselves, but for the love of God and the love of others. In our busy life, because we all are busy, very busy, especially at this time as we prepare for Christmas. There are so many things that we are supposed to do. And 4 weeks is not enough time to be really very prepared for what people understand, what this season of holiness is. This is how John the Baptist preached repentance in the River Jordan. This is how he dressed. This is what he said. This is what he did. The message of prepare the way have to be preached now, again and again. How good we do it. Like John the Baptist, more than 2,000 years ago, perhaps we wouldn't dress like him, or we wouldn't behave like John the Baptist in the River Jordan, surely not. How good we preach the message, prepare the way, this Advent, today, on Walton Vale, 2019. I bring to you some ideas on how the 1970s people preached this message for people of their time. And I want to come to our attention this musical based upon the Gospel of Matthew, that is this year's Gospel. How did the hippies in the 1970s preached the message, prepare the way? Seems crazy these days that people would actually give up their jobs, money making. In the 1970s, they gave up their job. They stopped making money and followed their heart. It did happen for a little while. And this scene has such a unique and joyful vibe. Can we watch this video clip, please?
How people
in the 1970s preached the message of St. John the Baptist. A little bit different from what St. John the Baptist did 2,000 years ago, and perhaps a little bit different of what we have to do nowadays to preach this message. But I think that we need to respect these hippies of the 70s, because they went against that generation of making money, busy life, and stopped that and followed their heart. And this is the way they found to preach the message of repentance. What way are we finding to preach nowadays this message? If you see around you what's happening in the streets, if you go to the shops, what is Christmas preparation about? It's all light in the street, shopping, crazy traffic jam, consumerism, focus on things that are not important. How many of our people in the streets are celebrating Jesus Christ at Christmas? Regarding this video clip, people said, a time when young people actually were wholesome and worshipped God. This is what purest joy looks like. They are all going about their own business, unaware that their lives are about to change forever. Honestly, Christians can get really crazy when it comes to praising God, so I wouldn't be surprised if we did this. This is what people from that generation wrote nowadays after seeing this video clip. I loved being a child of the 70s. I got saved in 1974. This music reminds me of the joy and simplicity of being a baby Christian. 40 years later, it seems a hard journey, but God is faithful. No one checked their pocket for mobile phones before jumping in the fountain. It is a very interesting one-man translation of the gospel, with all the limitation inherent in one-man translation. But it does an excellent job of causing us to think about what Jesus and the disciples would look like to our contemporary, or at least 1970s contemporary, society. This message prepared the way. Repent, the Lord is coming. Should touch our heart deeply today. This is the way the generation of hippies in the 1970s preached the message of John the Baptist. Quite different from how St. John the Baptist preached more than 2,000 years ago. We need to find a way to preach this same message. If we don't teach our children to put Jesus Christ back into Christmas, the world will teach them not to do it. What is our way to go into the streets and to say to the world, the Lord is coming, prepare the way? We need to put Jesus back into Christmas. We need to find a way, but we need to do it. It's an urgent message during this Advent season.